Sunday school program is indeed a gift, and while its inspiration comes from the people in our church, its origin is from God. God is the great giver of all gifts, and each day we have so many wonderful things that surround us that we too often take for granted, particularly in this world of so much bad news. It's really important, really crucial to remember that there is more good news than bad in this world. There's more light than darkness. There's more inspiration than despair. And we try here to capture that reality, that truth, and gather it here and reflect it out to the wider world through who we are as Christian people, and the ministries we undertake here at First Congregational Church. So right now, as we sing the doxology, I do invite your offerings. We are taking that, if you're new to our church, in a contactless way. There are offering plates at the exits that you can put your contribution in on your way out today. Remembering that your contribution is a way of making your faith tangible, to making your faith come alive in a real way through this church. And as I say, the ministries we undertake here to enliven God's spirit that's so apparent in this world so that others feel it and this world can become a better place. Your offering is invited. You know, playing lay reader here this morning, I neglected to share a couple of announcements with you with the offering this morning. But this day is such a day of celebration of the children in our church, the ministries around the children and youth of our church. And after worship today, I hope that we'll get some attendance at a meeting directly following right here in the sanctuary about Sunday school and our Sunday school program for next fall, as this is the last day of the Sunday school program for this program year. We'll be beginning again next fall. Laura and Michelle are rotating off as deacons of Christian education. Ashley Tegan, who came up as a teacher, you may have seen her come up. She's going to be coming on board as a deacon of Christian education. And we're looking for new ideas and vision for where we would like to go with the Sunday school program, and some new energy, some new ideas. So an open meeting. As I say, the Sunday school program is not just an effort of the Board of Deacons or the Christian Education Deacons or the parents or the teachers. It's an act of the congregation. So the congregation as a whole is invited to participate because the program reflects who we are as a congregation. So that's after worship this morning right here in the sanctuary. Speaking of the Board of Deacons, their June meeting will be this Tuesday, 7 o'clock here at the church. We'll be starting with our annual strawberry shortcake. That's a meeting for those who are staying on the board, those who are rotating off the board, and those who are coming on new to the board. A time of orientation and celebration, Tuesday evening, 7 o'clock here at the church. Next Sunday is Father's Day Sunday, so hope you can return for a celebration of that. After the worship service next Sunday, too, those who would like are invited to Jim and Lisa Osterman's home for the annual pool party. At their home, so I think it's from 1 to 4 next Sunday. All are welcome, provided it's not pouring down rain. Also, looking ahead to the final Sunday of June, our annual June cookout will be that Sunday following an outdoor worship service. So we'll be worshiping on the front lawn of the church on the last Sunday of June, it's the 26th, and then we'll be moving off to the playground to share our annual cookout. Sign-ups for that. If you'd like to participate and bring some stuff for the cookout or help out in any way, there is a sign-up board out in the narthex for that. Did you have an announcement? You had your hand up. Okay. Awesome. It's good to stretch. We've been here a while. All right. I love church school Sunday. It's great to get the kids up here. It's great to hear their experience in the Sunday school program each year in different ways. And This year, we've combined it with Bible Sunday with the third and fourth graders. And so I want to direct what I'm going to say to them, having received their Bibles this morning. And it's I could say a whole lot about the Bible, but I'm not going to take up the whole day with that. But I want to just give you some things to think about. So starting place to think about. So let me, those who have received the Bibles today, and for everybody too. How many of you have been down to the Melrose Public Library? How many of you have been in the children's room of the Melrose Public Library? Down in the basement there, right? And it's a nice room down there. I spent a whole lot of time down there when my kids were young. It's a great place, and there's a whole bunch of books in there, and other material too, right? It's a lot of books in there. And a good way to think about the Bible is that the Bible is like a library. It's like the Melrose Public Library, in a way, because it's not so much a book, but it's a collection of different books. A whole bunch of different books are in the one book. So I like to think of it as a library of different books. But if you go down into the Melrose, let's say you go down in the Melrose Public Library's children's room, and you go down there and you go off to the corner and that's like on the parking lot side in the front of that room, and you say, okay, I'm going to start here, and I'm going to read every book on this wall back to the back of the building, and then I'm going to cut over and cut across to the back side of the building and up to the front. And I'm going to keep going. I'm going to read every book down here, and then I'll be done. And then I'll move upstairs and read all those books. You think anybody ever does that? I don't think they do. Well, it's kind of like that with the Bible, too. It's okay if you don't read from the first book to the end of the book, end of the Bible. Okay? It's okay if you don't start with Genesis and finish with Revelation. Because, as I say, it's a library of different books. You can start in the middle if you want to. Some people I know, try to read from, and maybe some do, from Genesis to Revelation. I always get caught up with Leviticus. That just slows me down right there. If you've ever read Leviticus, I kind of stop there. If you're reading right through. But it's okay to pick and choose with your new Bible where you would like to go in there. There's some great things, and particularly the version you have has some questions in it, some great ways of kind of engaging with what's written in there. But it's often helpful to know how the Bible is organized. There's two main parts of the Bible. One is called the Old Testament, or sometimes called the Hebrew Scriptures. And that's the part of the Bible that was written before the time of Jesus. And the Old Testament is most of the Bible. Most of the Bible is made up of the Old Testament. It's the bigger part. The other part of the Bible is called the New Testament, and that's the part that's written about Jesus and the life of Jesus. It was written by his followers. And in that, whether it's the Old Testament or the New Testament, it's organized in a kind of helpful way by names of the books, and then each book has chapters and what's called verses. Which wasn't always the case, by the way. In the early manuscripts that we have of the books in the Bible, there isn't any of that. It's just words after words after words after words. And when it got to the English language, they thought, this is really tough to read. So why don't we break it up a little bit? And so in the 1500s, they put in chapters and broke up into verses. Verses are numbered sentences or groups of sentences in the paragraphs. So that makes it a little bit easier to read. So in the New Testament, which is the part that we tend to concentrate on as Christian people, the part about Jesus, there are what's called Gospels, and there are four of those. They're named Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, who were followers of Jesus. And the stories in there are written about the life of Jesus and the things that he taught, the places that he went, and his life. Some of the stories in there are the same in each of those four Gospels. Some of them are the same stories that are told in a little bit different way. And some of them are only show up in one of the four Gospels. So you got the Gospels. And then if you've ever wondered what happened after Jesus died and rose again on Easter and then ascended into heaven to live with God, what happened after that? Where happened? There's another book after the Gospels called the Book of Acts. The Book of Acts, or Acts of the Apostles, tells all about that, how the church started, what happened to those disciples. So if you want to know about that, that's what follows the Gospels. And then there's a bunch of letters, sometimes called epistles, which is another word for letters. And most of them, not all of them, but most of them were written by a man named Paul. I just read one from him this morning. The Apostle Paul was a follower of Jesus, and he went out and formed a bunch of churches, one of the first churches that were ever formed. And after he left, he would write letters back to them. And those letters are collected there after the Book of Acts. And the whole New Testament ends with a book called Revelation, which is a really interesting book. It's full of visions and dreams and things about heaven, and tell us a little bit more about God. Some interesting thoughts there, kind of at the end of the Bible. So you got your Old Testament, you got your New Testament, you got your chapters and your verses. And in the New Testament, you've got four Gospels, Book of Acts, letters, Book of Revelation. The question I often get is it true? Is it true? The things you read in the Bible, is it true or not? Especially from younger kids. It's a great question. And it's a question that's debated, really, in a lot of ways. Is it true? There's a great quote that I heard. I don't know who said it. Whenever there's a quote they don't know who said it, it's always Winston Churchill. So we'll say he said it. Winston Churchill said it. I don't know if it actually happened, but I know it's true. I don't know if it actually happened, but I know it's true. What does that mean? It means that the truth or the lessons in the story are more important than the story. And that's really the case with the Bible, the Bibles you got. It's really important to remember that the truths of how you live your life, the difference between right and wrong, those lessons are more important than the story. They're more important than when Jesus came out of the temple, he went left or right. That's less important than what he taught. So it's important not to get caught up in those details of who went where and that kind of stuff. The importance of the Bible is the image of God, the picture of God that you get from reading it, from the different stories. That's what's really most important. So is it true? Yes, it's true. Did everything happen exactly the way it's shown in the Bible? Maybe, and that's enough. But as I said with the blessing, this is your book. I want to stress that. This is your book as a Christian person. And it's okay to read the Bible and say, yes, I agree with that. Yes, that looks great. And yes, oh, wait a minute, that doesn't make any sense. What does that mean? Or, wait a minute, I don't agree with that. That's okay. But when that happens, ask yourself, why? Why do I feel that way? Why do I think differently? Because that is how you grow. That's how you figure out what you believe, what's important to you. It helps you clarify that for yourself. That's how you grow. So, because I don't think God wants blind obedience from us. God wants honesty of heart. To come to this out of who you are and your lived experience. So, because it's all about those stories, right? The stories of the Bible and your story. So how does your story fold into the stories of Scripture so that you can find God in your life just as the people who wrote those stories in the Bible found God in their lives? Because it's all about how the Bible is the stories of people trying to figure out their relationship with God. And we're trying to do the same thing through the lives that we lead. So your story is important too. And it needs to fold into the life of Scripture as well. So take your time with the Bible. And know that I'm around if you have questions about the Bible, because you can probably tell I love talking about it. A lot more I could say about it. But know I'm around if you have questions. I'm happy to talk more about it with you. But most importantly, may you find the great love of God in your life through Scripture. The great love that God has for you reflected in the pages of sacred scripture. And may your life become the next New Testament as you fold your story into the heritage of our faith. Let us pray. Oh, Holy God, we thank you for this church. We thank you for Church School Sunday and this third and fourth grade Bible Sunday. We thank you for the children and youth of our church. We thank you for all of the adults who have stepped up to teach and to learn with our church children. We thank you for our faith, a faith that invites us to find our own path to you. Along that path, we find many tools, and chief among them is prayer. So we pray now with and for those who are hurting and afraid in our church community and beyond. Be with them and give them comfort and strength. Remind them that they are never apart from your love and compassion. Help us all to be instruments of your peace and reflections of your joy so that true wholeness and healing may be felt in our hurting world. Bless First Congregational Church, O God, and all that we are yet to accomplish in the spirit of your Son, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray.